So friends, today is a momentous day for us because today is the 79th session. Tomorrow we will be entering our 80th session. In the 79th session, we are dealing with a very, very interesting topic, vicarious liability under criminal law. The session will be taken by Sri Gautam Kumar Chaudhary, who is the director of Ranchi Jharkhand Judicial Academy at Ranchi. And to introduce the subject, we have Justice Nagamuthu sir, and to grace the occasion and for having better interaction and inputs, we have Justice V. Ramkumar, Justice Abraham Matthew, and Justice K. Ramachandran sir are also with us today. And all of you who have been in this journey of interaction, empowerment. So as usual, we don't want to waste any time on anything. Over directly to Nagamuthu sir to introduce the topic.
Good evening, my dear brothers and sisters.
Good evening.
Good evening. Yes. I am very happy to introduce today's topic, that is vicarious liability in criminal law. Before introducing, I would like to welcome our speaker, with whom I do not have any personal acquaintance, but I have heard that he will be in a better position to clarify many of our doubts in so many areas on this concept. Now, so far as the concept of vicarious liability is concerned, we all know that this concept is very well accepted and recognized in civil law in most of the subjects. But so far as criminal law is concerned, we know very well that the term vicarious liability has not been used anywhere in the most comprehensive criminal law, namely the Indian Penal Code. In the other special enactments also, to my knowledge, this language vicarious liability is rarely used or not used at times, though they actually convey the very same sense. Now, what do we mean by vicarious liability? To introduce the subject or the concept, I will say that for the act which amounts to an offense committed by one person, the other person will be held liable, responsible for punishment. For example, if A commits an act which amounts to a crime, how B can be held responsible for that? This liability we call as vicarious liability. This concept of vicarious liability has got no role, no place at all in the criminal law, yet barring in certain circumstances when there are special provisions made in certain special enactments. Now, so far as IPC is concerned, and we have got section 34 of the code, which says that if an act is committed by several persons in furtherance of a common intention, and if that major act constitutes an offense, it is deemed by fiction that everyone who participates in the commission of the crime is liable for punishment as though he alone was committed the crime. Please kindly take note of the language of section 34, which says, in furtherance of the common intention of all, each of such persons is liable for that act in the same manner as if it were done by him alone. For example, suppose two people form a common institution, they share a common intention to go and commit murder of one X. They go to the house of X. A, the first man, stands outside the house, and B alone enters into the house. A closes the door, keeps himself, waiting outside.
Guarding
anybody from coming there and also preventing the person from inside escaping. Now the person who enters into the house is B and he commits the crime. Now A cannot escape later on saying that I did not cause the death, because section 299 starts with the language, with the expression that whoever commits the crime, whoever causes the death. Now here, B alone caused the death. He is liable for murder. He did not do anything. So far as the deceased is concerned, he was only waiting outside. Even then, this is no defense at all for him, because though he cannot be convicted under section 302, he has to be convicted by invoking section 34. The law creates a fiction. If you kindly see these words, in the same manner as if it were done by him alone, which means what? He alone has committed the murder. By invoking section 34, it is to be deemed that he alone committed the murder, and therefore he has to be punished. And B alone has committed the murder, and therefore he should also be punished by invoking section 34. Though the A's act is a very small act, very minor act, still he is liable for the major act which culminated, that is for murder. Here in section 34, though they have not used the word, the expression, vicarious liability, in effect, we are applying the same principle here. Now, apart from that, we have got section 149. There, if any one of the members of the unlawful assembly sharing the common object commits a crime, then every one member of the unlawful assembly is liable. The only condition is that the crime should have been committed in prosecution of the common object. Now, what is the common object that is dealt with in section 141? So I do not want to go into that. This is the second place where we apply to some extent the principle of vicarious liability, though not in clear terms, it is so expressed in the provision itself. To my knowledge, apart from these two provisions, there is no other provision in the IPC, including section 109 or 120B. They are independent offenses. There is no vicarious liability in those things. For the act committed by them, for instigation, they are punished under 109. For aiding, they are punished, not vicariously. And so far as 120B is concerned, for having conspired, they are punished. There is no vicarious liability at all involved in that. So these are the two provisions in the IPC. Now take the case of the special enactments. There are provisions where this concept or this principle of vicarious liability is kept in mind, and provision is made to punish a person vicariously. For example, you take the case of 138 and 141. For the offense committed by the company, anyone who was in charge of the day-to-day affairs of the company is also held liable for punishment. This is precisely the vicarious liability. That is, for the offense committed by the company is punished, and apart from the company, someone else who was responsible for the day-to-day affairs of the company is also punished. This is one illustration as to how in a special enactment this principle has been brought into use. Then there is another concept. We know about that alter ego. Alter ego means, so far as a company or corporation is concerned, the managing director, for example, is the alter ego of the company. If the alter ego, namely the managing director, commits a crime, their company can be held responsible. Yes, applying this doctrine of alter ego, the company can also be held liable. This has been very elaborately held by a constitutional bench of the Honorable Supreme Court in Standard Chartered Bank case reported in 2005, 4 ACC, page 530. Then, so far as the criminal liability is concerned, applying the alter ego, when the alter ego, that is the eye of the company, when he commits a crime, the company can be held liable, but not the reverse. That was dealt with recently by our Honorable Supreme Court in the famous case of 2G, reported in 2015, 4 ACC, page 609. This is by a 3-judge bench. Judgment was authored by Honorable Justice A.K. Sikri. Please, all of you, kindly read this judgment. Very elaborately, the judgment has dealt with the concept of alter ego, concept of vicarious liability, and it has also been held that so far as IPC offenses are concerned, this applying the alter ego for the offense committed by the company, the managing director, or anybody else in the company cannot be held liable. So to put it in a nutshell about the facts, I will say that in that case, the government officials gave license to certain companies. for 2G. Now, the officials and the companies were arrayed as accused. When final report was filed before the court, the magistrate issued a summon not only to the accused who were arrayed as accused in the charge sheet, but to others also, namely the persons, namely managing director and others who are responsible for the day-to-day affairs of the company. Now, the Honorable Supreme Court held that for the offence committed by these companies, these officers of the company, namely managing director and others, cannot be held liable at all. The doctrine of alter ego cannot be reversely applied. So the Honorable Supreme Court has also further held very elaborately that there is no question of applying the principle of vicarious liability at all in this case. That is, for the offense committed by the company, you cannot prosecute and punish the managing director and others. So these are the fundamental principles and about which we are going to today have very meaningful and effective debate. And with this introductory remarks, because I do not want to take much of the time, as we are very anxious to hear our speaker. With this introductory remarks, I will hand over the platform to our speaker. Sir, please take over and explain to us all as to what are these concepts and how, not only conceptually, but also practically these things are being applied in this country. Please.
Thank you, sir. My regards to the honorable members from the bar as well as the bench. I feel the first thought that comes to my mind that I have before me a very legally informed fraternity before me. So I don't claim to present great nuances of law. I will be only presenting the perspectives because the perspective changes. Law is something, as we all know, it is very entwined with the life of the society. And as the changes in society is there, the context changes and law's perspective also changes. So before I come to the topic directly, I'm reminded of today, in the Times of India quote, I read a quote by Napoleon Bonaparte, just above the editorial column. The quote says that the infectiousness of crime is like that of the plague. The infectiousness of the crime is like that of the plague. So when the news from Uttar Pradesh and other places that now hog the limelight today regarding accused persons having 60 and more cases pending before them, so that is the perspective of the crime. And so it brings the relevance of the topic here, because why this topic becomes very relevant today, because the modus operandi of the crime is changing fast. There are crimes, sir, as you all know, that they are committed on the spur of moment for a small, maybe village, small piece of land, pathway. And there are larger crimes which are planned. And there are, in such crimes, there are unseen hand behind the crime. So when we talk about vicarious liability, as sir very pertinently stated in that it is, this is a principle which has come from civil law, tortious liability of master and servant. Then we have constructive liability. Constructive liability is something where the criminal act has not been done personally by him, but the liability is constructed on the basis of a legal fiction. And then we have joint liability. So all these three concepts, as we see in our criminal jurisprudence, have been used interchangeably, not with a very strict connotations. So I will use my PowerPoint to put some of my views that I want to share with the participants and the audience here. At the outset, sir, I want to open the discussion with an observation of Honorable the Supreme Court made in Sriharan case. This observation I want to read out because this brings to the poignancy of the situation. Lawlessness is the order of the day. Having got the experience of dealing with cases involving major crimes, we can authoritatively say that even the kith and kin and close relatives, friends, neighbors, and passerby who happen to be witness to the occurrence and are threatened, and though initially they give statement to the police, invariably turned hostile, apparently because of the threat meted out to them by the hardened and professional criminals and gangsters. So this is the background in which the system operates, in which the legal principles are tested. Because as we all know that we have a very pragmatic document in the form of either in Evidence Act, Procedure Code, which where even going by the definition of proof as in Evidence Act, it is all about a prudencement test. So the pragmatism is there, and so the court, while interpreting any provision of law, the factual background has to be considered. So coming back to the topic, sir. So as we see, constructive liability means the liability of a person for an offense he has himself not committed. Because the phrase constructive liability means and connotes the sense that a person is liable for consequence of an act of another, even though he has not done it himself. Vicarious liability is one of those liabilities that is imposed on one person for the wrong action of others. But further going down to the concept, because in as I stated just before, that crime in most cases is a outcome of a joint criminal enterprise. There are crimes which are committed on the spur of moment by an individual, but it is also an outcome of joint planning, conspiracy. And in order to meet such situation, if the main perpetrator is only held responsible, and those who are behind that, so therefore these provisions have been made. Further, the one interesting part of this is that when Indian Penal Code was drafted in 1860, we all know that at that time, even in England, the Penal Code was not drafted at that time. So they drew heavily, as far as the British law was concerned, that they had made a difference between the principal offenders who took part in actual execution of the crime and those who counseled, procured, and commanded its execution. So there were two classes. The first was the principal offender, and the second was the accessories. So when we come to accessories of the crime, the accessories, there were three types of accessories. The first was the accessories before the fact, or meaning thereby, accessories before the incidents. Accessories at the fact, and accessories after the fact. So when Macaulay was drafting the Penal Code, so these broad concepts of English common law influenced a lot in the draft. And in its chapterization, the way the chapters were made, the way the offenses were classified, this is very much visible. For instance, in our code, the accessories before the fact, in chapter 4 from section 107, that is abatement chapter, ending to 118 abatement, then it is conspiracy till 120B. So these are the provisions which we can say broadly are the provisions dealing with accessories before the incidents. Then we have accessories at the time of fact, not the principal offender, because as far the principal offender is concerned, there is no problem. The charge can be framed in the light of section 218 of the CRPC for the distinct offense he has committed. And there is no need, there are direct on the basis of the materials on record, there is nothing further required. These provisions regarding accessories are required to rope in those persons who are not, who may not be directly the main principal offenders. So these accessories at the fact can be looked at in put in perspective from section 34 to section 38 under chapter 2 and section 149 of the IPC. Then we have accessories after the fact. It does not come under vicarious liability. They are scattered in different places of the penal code, dealing mainly with the harboring of the offenders, those who have harbored the crime. They are like 130, 136, 157, and so on. So coming back to section 34 to 38. So 34 to 38 has been put in the chapter of general explanation, which chapter does not create any offense. It is only interpretive in the sense. So section 34, as sir very just now, before that, before we enter into a discussion into different sections from section 34 to 38, 149 and other provisions, I have tried to broadly put these in one pie chart. And how it is, sir, you see at the center, the red mark. So here is the principal offender. So if the principal offender is there, we don't need any assistance of any provision. He can be directly charged. So if there was an unlawful assembly of say 20 people and the main person had fired the shot, the charge is to be framed against him under section 302 without the assistance of 149, although it is a substantive offense. So he can be charged under 302 along with other members of unlawful assembly with 149. So even if the charge under 149 fails, he can be held guilty for section 302. So the smallest circle is the circle for the main principal offender. Then comes a bit larger circle. This is for the persons who are the participants, who have participated in the crime physically by being present at the place of occurrence to a large extent. So that this take care, section 34 takes care of, because section 34 says that when a criminal act is done by several persons in furtherance of common intention of all, each of such persons shall be liable for the act in the same manner as if it has been done by him alone. So for the participants part, sir, you will recall Parinder Kumar Ghosh, even if he is standing outside the post office, he will be roped in with the help of section 34. That is the next circle. Now the third circle is about person who is not a participant. He is not participating in the crime. He is just a member of the unlawful assembly and sharing the common object of the assembly. So it is another big circle. So there section 149 comes. So simply because of your membership of the unlawful assembly, you are there, the criminal liability is fixed on you on the basis of your membership of the unlawful assembly. Then the last circle is about persons who are neither at the place of occurrence, neither who have participated in the offense, except for section 114. We will discuss it a bit later. It is about abatement. Suppose I have abated a crime. I'm sitting idle at my home, but with the aid of section 109, I can be roped into the crime. Similar is the case of criminal conspiracy. He did not go to the place of occurrence. He just entered into an agreement to commit an offense. So these are, this is the way how the liability is sought to be fixed on persons who are not direct participants. But from there, here we move to, sir has already thrown light on this part. Section 34, we are very much familiar with. Here the word is criminal act. So they are the crux of the liability is the act, criminal act should be done in furtherance of common intention. And the participation should be there. And the law, in order to, the law as it has evolved through judicial precedents, now how to determine it, that he has shared the common intention or not. So the element of prior concert of mind which may develop at this spot. So some overt act needs to be there. Even if he has contributed at the place, not by simply striking. And this section was required really for the reason that suppose there can be two situations. There can be one situation where maybe four, because number is not, even seven persons, the liability under section 34 can be fixed. So if more than two persons are conjointly assaulting a person leading to his death, we don't know whose act was the fatal act. So the joint liability is fixed on all the persons who were involved in the assault. And here, the another interesting thing is that the individual intention of committing the offense need not be proved. It is only the common intention is to be proved. There is a presumption of individual intentions. So the burden of proving individual intention is not, because once the act is committed, furtherance of common intention, and the person is there, whether even if it is for robbery and death has occurred in consequence of that, then he cannot escape liability on the plea that I never intended the death of the person in whose house the robbery was committed. So here this is another beautiful part of section 34. There are two landmark cases, sir. Every one of us are aware of that. I will just throw a light on that. This is a Mehboob Shah versus King Emperor. This is a Privy Council decision, EIR 1945, Privy Council 148. So, sir, in this case, what happened? I will just re-narrate the story. There were more than four or five persons. They had conjointly assaulted. But there the Privy Council made a very vital distinction between common intention of all and similar intention of all. So they had not combined there to commit murder. They had gone there only to prevent the other party from collecting the reeds and other things that was there in the case. So on this interpretation in this case, Mehboob Shah was, section 34 was, 4 was held not to apply to Mehboob Shah. And in view of section 38 of the IPC, he was responsible for his individual act and not for the act of the main person who had committed the crime. A very interesting question came in Suresh versus State of UP 2001, Volume 3, SCC. The question was, when we say presence, what do we mean by presence? Whether virtual presence will also suffice? So suppose if a person is not exactly at the place of occurrence, but he's directing the events and the actions by means of, say, mobile or something, audio-visual means. So or binocular in this case, it was binocular which was there. And there are lordships held, that it has been held in this case, that were on one of such person in furtherance of common intention, overseeing the action from a distance through binoculars gives instructions by mobile, section 34 will apply. Further, this is the celebrated judgment of Barendra Kumar Ghosh and the very famous line of Lord Sumner, because the question in that case was whether for the murder of the postmaster, the person who was watching watching outside the post office, whether he should be criminally liable for that or not. So there is lots of very famously observed in crime as well as in life. He also serves who merely stands and waits. And this is how Section 35(4) was applied here. I will move quickly to now 34 is a section, as we have while working in the courts, we have seen that there is a tendency of the litigants to rope in the entire family. They have out of vengeance. So both Section 34 and 149 is a section which has to be very carefully applied. There are umpteen cases where false implications are done with the help of Section 34 as well as 149. So the principle that has been laid down in State of Bihar versus Surendra Singh Rautela by the Supreme Court, that in case of free clash, sudden fight, Section 34 will not apply.
Is it Supreme Court or Jharkhand?
No, this one is Jharkhand, sir. You are, sir, right? But this is this
case. You have shown it as Jharkhand.
Yes, sir, exactly.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. So, and this is I stand corrected, sir.
Yes, no problem.
So, but this is the principle, well-settled principle, but in the event of sudden fight or free clash where several persons are involved, so normally the Section 34 will not apply, because that pre-concert of mind, the pre-planning, those things are not there. Now, this is a very interesting question that once one of my trainee asked me. They asked me that in Section 304, Part 2, this culpable homicide not amounting to murder when it has been done with a knowledge. And suppose the charge has been framed under Section 34, 304, read with Section 34, IPC. And on the basis of the facts of the case, it is found that it is not a case of intention, but it is a case of culpable homicide with knowledge. And so in that case, 304(2) applies. Then the question is whether Section 34 can be applied or not. So there is a direct authority on this point in Afrahim Sheikh versus State of West Bengal, AIR 1964 Supreme Court 1263. The question is whether this second part of 304 can be made applicable. The second part no doubt speaks of knowledge and does not refer to intention, which has been segregated in the final part. But knowledge is the knowledge of the likelihood of the death. And it said that on the basis, even if the charge is framed under Section 34, the Section 34 can be applied if the finding of fact is that 304 Part 2 applies. Further, in this case, now this case is relevant also, because this takes us to section relevance of Section 35. Because 35 is a very interesting section. There some word in furtherance of common intention of all goes away. Now this in furtherance of common intention of all is an expression in the Indian Penal Code, which was not in its original draft of 1860. It was inserted by way of amendment in 1870. So another interesting part is Section 35(4) was not in the draft of prepared by Macaulay of Indian Penal Code. Section 34 was not there. Section 111 was not there. Section 113 was not there. But when the committee was headed by Burns Peacock, the Chief Justice of Calcutta High Court at that time. So when the committee looked into the draft prepared by Macaulay, they made the proposal to insert Section 34, 111 and 113. So in this form, 34 came in the Penal Code. But now there is a school of thought going on, particularly I saw in Singapore and all, they are highly critical about the provision of Section 34. That line of argument is that the provision of abatement as provided under 107 to 109, 10 and other provisions, they are sufficient to take the eventuality of Section 34 also. But be that as it may, it is only a matter of academic interest. Section 34 is on our statute book and it has served the purpose to a great extent. So in Ephraim Sheikh, that principle was said that there is no reason why Section 34 or Section 35 because should not be read with second part of 304. This part, now I think my work has become very easy because His Lordship Nagamuthu has very clearly stated the point regarding vicarious liability of company. The fact of the matter is that under Indian Penal Code, the principle of vicarious liability on the directors of the company cannot be imputed. Yes, it can be done on the basis of Section 138, 141 of the NIA Act, Negotiable Instrument Act, and other provisions. But as far as the Indian Penal Code is concerned, well, I inserted for our trainees because there are very large number of incidents. Suppose a dharna pradarshan takes place before the management, and from that side, some firing takes place by the security personnel, and maybe some people die in that. So what the people do, a complaint is filed implicating from the managing director to everybody, and that too under penal code provisions. So to my understanding, the different authorities that on the point are, apart from the Standard Chartered Bank and other cases that sir had referred, that this is what STFC Securities Limited versus State of Maharashtra 2017 1JBCJ AIR citation is also there. The IPC does not provide for vicarious liability for any offense alleged to be committed by the company. If and when a statute contemplates creation of such legal friction, it can be provided like NIA, as sir has already elaborated on that point. This issue again came in Sharad Kumar Sanghi versus Sangat Rane. The allegations which find place against managing director in his personal capacity seem to be absolutely vague. When complainant intended to rope in the managing directory or any officer of the company, it is essential to make a requisite allegation which constitute the vicarious liability. It does not say that they cannot be made liable in any case. If they are directly involved in the offense, then they can be made liable for IPC offense, but not with the aid of Section 34, not with the aid of any of the sections by which vicarious liability is fixed. If there are imputation directly against the directors or managing director, they may be anyone. So that liability can be fixed, but not on the basis that some other person has committed, the security, chief security officer has committed, therefore the MD will be made responsible. So this is the principles that have come. The Supreme Court went further in this case. In Maqsood Sayyed versus State of Gujarat 2008, volume 5, SCC 668. So in this case, what the magistrate did, he forwarded the complaint under Section 156(3) for registration of FIR. So the Honorable Apex Court said that when the offense is not being made out, when there is no such thing, then why you have forwarded it? So this practice of forwarding was deprecated by the Apex Court, where the directors and so were held liable and so on. This is also, I don't need to repeat the same, this is also to the same effect, that unless and until there is a specific allegation against respondent number 227, the summons cannot be issued. It is also to the same effect. Now let us come to Section 35, sir. What is the need of Section 35? We have Section 34. Its need arises on two counts. The first count is, as stated in a Ephraim Sheikh case, So there may be instances where there may be lack of, there is no common intention, but knowledge may be there, intention may be there. So here the expression in furtherance of common intention goes further. In this section, it is not requirement of law to prove the prior concert of mind. So whenever any act which is criminal, only by reason of it being done with criminal knowledge or intention, is done by several persons, each of such person who joins in the act with such knowledge or intention is liable for the act in the same manner as if the act were done by him alone with that knowledge or intention. So as far as section 34 is concerned, I commit a fraction of the act and I am liable for the whole. The liability for the, I did commit only the fraction of the part. Here, I commit the fraction of the part with the knowledge, and then I am made liable for the whole. Now the difference, another difference that I could make out, that there is a presumption of intention as far as section 34 is concerned. Once the my act has been proved to be in furtherance of common intention of all, then my individual intention need not be proved. I can be imputed that I also intended the same act. But here that this, as far as section 35 is concerned, the individual intention of the participant need to be proved. This will be a bit clear from the Bhopal gas tragedy case, in which this case was applied. So that is how section 34 says. Section 34 enacts that each and every person who performs even the fractional part of the act in furtherance of common intention is deemed to be regarded as performer of whole of it. But where the performer has the requisite intention of individual fractional act, but not the common intention for the whole, then in terms of section 35, he will be liable only for his fractional act alone. So now this principle was tested in case of Bhopal gas tragedy case. Sir, as all of us know, that is case of Mahindra versus state of Madhya Pradesh. So the tragedy took place and the question was, and there was negligence on part of different functionaries of the company. Case of Mahindra was the director or manager of the Bhopal gas. And a case was filed under 304(2) with section 35 of the IPC against him. And the matter went up to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court finally held that this section 35 will not apply. 304(2) will not apply. Section 304A read with section 35 will apply. That is how the Supreme Court held that. So here, before we go to that judgment, section 34 does not use the expression offense, but it uses the expression criminal act. Section 35 uses expression and act. So here, as further as intention or knowledge, I wanted to come to that judgment. As I had said that here the preconcerted plan need not be proved. In this case, Bhopal gas tragedy, JT 1996, case of Mahindra versus state of MP, in this case, the charge under 304(2) read with section 35 was quashed. And the charge was directed to be framed under section 304A read with section 35. The effect of section 35 is that although an act may be done conjointly by two or more persons, it is only such of them as do the act with a criminal intention or knowledge that will be liable and not others. As sir, we all of us, as we know, that intention is, all these offenses require intentions. But here, what it says, that I will be responsible for my individual act done with a criminal, for an intention, with relevant intention. Then we have section 36. Now, Section 36 is also another interesting provision in all these provisions from Section 34 to 37. Section 37 is 6 is a provision where, and I think this case was applied in Sushil Ansal case. Yes, sir. Effect caused partly by an act and partly by an omission. Act has been defined under, sir, as you know, under Section 32 of the Indian Penal Code, and which include omission also. Then Section 33 talks about series of act means and omission means series of acts and series of omissions. So here Section 36 comes to meet a situation where the partly there has been an act and partly there has been an omission. So wherever the causing of a certain effect or an attempt to cause the effect by an act or an omission is an offense, it is to be understood that the causing of that effect, partly by an act and partly by an omission, is the same thing. So there are three illustrations given in that section. I have not quoted all those illustrations, but they are very, those illustrations make the point very clear. Is that suppose a jailer in a jail, on his duty, poisons a prisoner, which is not sufficient to cause his death. Then another jailer comes, he beats him up. Or one of them stabs him, another comes and another does his part. So there is, if he's not providing him food, this is omission. Another is beating him, that is an act. So these acts, both will be held, can be what I say jointly liable under Section 36, with Section 36. So Section 34 and 35 consciously avoids the word intention or knowledge. Unlike Section 34 and 35, this section does not use the word intention or knowledge. So the plea of unintentional wrong cannot be taken when Section 36 is invoked. So this provision was used with effect. Sir, you will remember the case in Delhi where the fire took place in one of the cinema hall while the screening of the film Border was going on. So that case, many people died in that accident, fire incidents. And Sushil and Ansal was the manager or proprietor of that cinema hall. And there the charge were framed with under 304A, 337 and 338, read with 36 of the IPC. Because fact was there that he had not given sufficient fire exit in the cinema hall. And this omission and the transformer was installed within the cinema hall. So that and these act and omissions were sufficient to rope in the manager of the cinema hall, and the charge were fixed and this was upheld by the Delhi High Court. Section 37 is the in this chapter 2 is last in the series here. Here it takes care of another eventuality where the cooperation by doing one of several acts constituting an offense. The difference with Section 34 can be better appreciated by one illustration of conjoint assault by several persons, some giving blows, some stick blow, some knife injury, and some gunshot injury. The act done by them cannot be treated as several within the meaning of Section 36(7), because their purpose, these are not several acts. These are only one act to commit the murder of the person, to cause the death of the person. So they are doing one criminal act. There are different acts being done in furtherance of common intention to murder the victim, and Section 34 will squarely apply. The reason is that although several persons joined together in committing the crime and the injuries may have been caused by various acts, their acts constitute from a common sense point of view one single act and not several different acts. Now Section 37 further clarifies that A and B are joint jailers. the prison alternately. I think this illustration is there in 36. I'm not sure. So basically, section 37 talks about cooperation by doing one of several acts. Sir, this I was yesterday. I was thinking on this section, sir. I was thinking because when we deal with cases on circumstantial evidence, because I will like to read section 37. I have not quoted it yet, but I will like to read it. This occurred to my mind. I just want to share with sir. Cooperation by doing one of several acts constituting an offense. When an offense is committed by means of several acts, whoever intentionally cooperates in the commission of that offense by doing any one of those acts, either singly or jointly with any other person, commits that offense. So the liability under section 37 is with regard to cases where an offense is committed by means of several, there are several acts, and the person who is thought to be made liable has done one of it part. Whoever intentionally cooperates in the commission of that offense by doing any one of those acts, either singly or jointly with any other person, commits that offense. So, sir, when I am reminded of Sucha Singh versus State of Punjab, where the terrorist picked up the deceased from his house, and the next day he was not found. So, with the aid of Section 106 of the Evidence Act, the Honorable Apex Court confirmed the conviction. So, even in our state, there are many cases of kidnapping. So, once the kidnapping takes place, there is first person who takes up the child. So, this comes in evidence. But the other chains do not come up. So, when the other chains do not come up, sometimes the cases fail because the chain is not complete. So, while I was reading this section yesterday, it occurred, why can't we use this section under section 37? Because this part has been proved, that where several acts constituting an offense, one part has been proved, he has cooperated in the offense. Sir, so this is the food of thought. I will like to hear something about this section 37.
Please explain why section 30, so you take the first illustration.
Sir,
37.
34,
30,
yes.
37. Yes, illustration 1.
Yes, sir.
Why can't we invoke section 34? You just see for this illustration. First illustration to section 37.
A and B agree to murder Z by severally and at different times, giving him small dose of poison. A and B administer the poison according to the agreement with intent to murder Z. Z dies from the effect of the several doses of poison so administered to him. Here A and B are intentionally cooperate in the commission of the murder, and each of them does an act by which the death is caused. They are both guilty of the offense, though their act are separate. Exactly, sir. Exactly.
So we can invoke section 34 for this illustration. We can invoke section 34. What are
sir, we? Each one 34 cannot be used. Yes, sir. 34 cannot be used because if kidnapping has taken place and after that murder has taken place, the person who was intermediary, we cannot have evidence that he was present at the time of murder. He participated in his death in the event. We can only get evidence that he was present. He was instrumental in kidnapping. No. So that last part, he was not there. So some way we can.
No, I fully agree with you. But I'm referring you to this illustration 1, A2, section 37.
Yes.
We can invoke section C, both two parties, each one plays their role, which ultimately culminate in the crime, major act. Each one has got a smaller act to do. One puts poison, the other man also adds poison. Two acts.
Yes, sir.
Two acts make out a larger single act of causing death.
Yes, sir.
That is what is required under section 34. So this illustration would, in my understanding, this Ram Kumar has also to explain. Why can't this explanation be brought under section 34?
But it is not at the same time.
No, it need not be on the same time. Need not be on section 34 does not say that it should be done at the same time. Participate in action. That is
one A criminal act.
Yes.
34.
No, no. Yeah, two acts. I am guarding outside. One act, it is my act. The other man enters and causes the death. It is a different act. But these two acts go together, make out a larger act of causing death. So each person is liable as though the causing of death was committed by him alone. Here, A poisons.
B also poisons.
Poisons. Both play
different, both different both point of time. Different point of time. So if when you are framing the charge, how will you frame the charge?
Charge. See,
date and time. Date and time.
So please take the very same illustration. I will extract the same thing. I will say, at the end, you have to say that both you have played one act. You have done one act. He has done one act. Smaller acts. Both put together make out a larger single act of causing death. That was out of common intention.
While framing the charge,
sharing intention is there. A and B agree.
All right.
A agree to commit murder. Very common intention. Out of the common intention, he does one thing, I do one thing. The other man does another thing. They agree. There is common, something common.
Different times.
Different times. Only distinction, different times. Section does not, 34 does not say it should be at the same time.
A criminal act. Section 34 says when a criminal act is done.
Yes. A criminal
act. Here the provision says several acts.
Several acts at different times.
Yes.
Here, the illustration I am saying.
All right.
Two different acts are done by two different people.
Yes.
A poisons. B also poisons. Two different acts. Several acts. Committed in person is a common intention. See, regarding substantive provision of section 37, I got no difficulty. I am concerned only with the illustration A.
You're right.
A more specifically suits section 34. That is what I feel. So I leave it to you. I leave it to your speaker, sir, please. Go ahead. It's only
thank you, sir.
Please go.
That was a very nice point raised, sir.
Yes.
So
yes,
coming forward, sir.
Yes.
38 is something which talks about several liability.
Yes.
It is not about joint liability. It is several liability. Yes. Section 34 and 35 creates responsibility for total result. Section 38 fastens individual responsibility. It's not about joint responsibility. Now the question is, as we discussed earlier also, next question arises about the criminal liability of a person who did not actually participate in the crime, but was the member of an unlawful assembly and an offense is committed in the prosecution of the common object. And for that, in order to project it, that second round was made, where the person is not the participant, but he's simply a member. He's not done anything. He has only shared the common object. Now there are a number of judgments. How to prove whether he shared the common object or not. There should be evidence to that effect, as sir, you all know. That there should be some evidence to the effect that he shared the common object. But the criminal liability does not require any act on his part, except for being member of the common unlawful assembly and sharing the common object. And the act being committed, criminal act being committed in the prosecution of the common object. So these are the points. The accused must be a member of the unlawful assembly. An offense must have been committed by another member of the assembly. The offense must have been committed in the prosecution of the common object of that assembly. The member of the assembly must have known that such offense was likely to be committed in prosecution of the common. The likelihood should be there in his mind. But there are certain, but this is also a section, sir, I don't know what happened. Initially, when I joined as an additional session judge, sir, in one of the case, I passed a judgment of conviction under section using this section. That was my first place of posting. And there was evidence to the effect that all of them were there. Now, after I awarded the sentence, one of the convict came to me and said, the judgment has been delivered, but I was not even present at the place of occurrence. So that was that. I was shocked, and that was a learning experience for me. In other place of posting, I was posted. It was a murder of 8 persons, multiple murder. Ultimately, the matter went up to the Supreme Court, and the death sentence was also confirmed by the Honorable Apex Court. Then I remember about 11 persons were made accused. I saw there were only 4 SLMs, and the 7 were not. They were related. They were resident of other villages. They were not supposed to be there on that night when the incidents took place. So somehow I wriggled out. I did not apply 149. And I convicted only those 4 persons. And that only 4, that conviction was upheld. So this section 149, well, particularly if the young lawyers are there who are hearing this, they have to be very wary and very careful while applying section 149. But this is because this is an area where there are chances of miscarriage of justice. So the requirement is prior formation of an unlawful assembly with a common object is not necessary, as the common object can develop instantly, unlawful assembly. And there is another interesting question, whether in a case where the normally there is a very good judgment of the Honorable Apex Court. We will discuss it later on. One is from Kerala, and another is a constitution bench, perhaps 5-judge bench of the Supreme Court, Mohan Singh versus State of Rajasthan. But there is another case, Palakom Abdul Rahim versus State of Kerala, 2019, Volume 4, SCC 795. This is an ideal case to my mind. And I discussed this case while dealing with section 149.34, framing of charge. The question for my young brothers and sisters, if they are there, is, suppose I have framed a charge against, say, 7 persons, read 302, read with 149. The principal offender, I have made a separate charge, 302. And then a separate charge has been framed against 7 persons, read with 149, who are the member of unlawful assembly. Now, if the court acquits, say out of 7, it acquits 4, whether the conviction can be, judgment of conviction can be passed. That is the question. Shyam, Brother Shyam, if any young lawyer will prefer to respond to this.
Definitely, I'll unmute, or should we keep it to the end so that this can be kept in a
Okay, bit? Okay. Because then this is very pertinent.
Yeah.
So this judgment, if anybody wants to respond, you can unmute his.
Yeah, of course. If anybody puts a hand icon, I'll immediately unmute. Otherwise, there'll be cacophony.
Okay, no problem. So the principle that has been decided in Mohan Singh versus State of Punjab or something, I will give the citation, is that when the charge is framed against, it does not matter. Charge can be framed under 302 with 149 against 2 persons also. 2 persons and others, unknown others, more than 5. It should be mentioned there. Or if you have framed a charge under 302 or against, read with 149, 5% and others, then the judgment can be delivered. Because there should be known or unknown person who were the members of unlawful assembly, and the court should come to a finding that there are more than 5 persons. But suppose if the charge is framed only against 5 persons, charge does not speak and talk about more than 5 persons. It is silent about it. The moment you acquit any, 149 goes. And only then, in that situation, the persons accused can be individually liable for the acts of their own. So if the charge is against anybody on 302. So why I this refer this case? The charge in this case was beautifully framed. The first charge was framed against 11 persons. 302 read with 149 against all. Then there was alternative charge. As we know, alternative charge is framed under section 221 of the CRPC. And that alternative charge was 302 read with 34 of the IPC against three persons. Now what happened? The 149 charge failed. And this 302 read with 34 held its fort up to the apex court against the three persons. Now I think this is the ideal way in which the charge should be framed. Because as we know, the landmark judgment on framing of charge regarding section 34 read with 302 is Williams Lanny case.
Williams Lanny, yes.
Judgment by V. Justice Vivian Bose, 1956 AIR page 116. That is a judgment worth reading for all my young friends, I will say that. So there the matter was William Slaney and Ronnie Slaney were two brothers. And the charge was framed and they were charged under 302, read with 34 of the IPC. And for joint liability. And on trial, what happened in that case? That Ronnie's facts, evidence came that Ronnie Slaney was, the sufficient evidence was not there against Ronnie Slaney. And he was acquitted. Then the question was whether a judgment of conviction can be returned against William Slaney. This was the crux of the question in that case. And at that time, just before William Slaney, 55, 56, there were two conflicting judgments. One was Nanak Chand, another was Suraj Pal. So in that case, Honorable Apex Court went in detail and said that the test is of prejudice to the accused. And if the body of the charge reflects the participation on action, now, then unless the prejudice is there, there is no wrong even if the charge is not framed. So here the ideal way the charge was framed, 3%, 302 by 34, arrest 140. I mean, 149 failed, they were convicted under 302, 34. And there, here the how the common object is to be, of an assembly is to be ascertained. Because as we know, the common object of the person is not to be basically seen into. The common object of the assembly is to be ascertained from the acts and language of the member composing to, and from consideration of all the surrounding circumstances like conduct of each member of unlawful assembly before the time and motive of the crime and so on. This is Sikandar Singh, State of Bihar, 2010, 7 SSC 477. Now there is another question. This is the question we were discussing about. And the only one judgment one need to read is Mohan Singh. This is Mohan Singh. AIR 174 Supreme Court. Mohan Singh versus State of Punjab. This is about the caution that has even the Apex Court has given as far as where large number of persons are alleged to have participated in the crime, and they are sought to be brought to book with the aid of Section 149. Only those accused whose presence was clearly established and an overt act of any one of them was proved should be convicted by taking into consideration particular fact. So whenever these things comes, I read very interesting part in one of the Singaporean journal. It says, it gives out a different principle, and I find that there is much worth in that. It says that let us see what is the nature of the crime. So there may be nature of crime where the innocent farmers may be involved. Family members out of both parties would have come suddenly. Their 149 would have been applied. And then There may be situation where an organized mafia are involved, organized crime is involved. In those cases, the same yardstick need not be applied. There should be more, we should be more inclined to accept that they were member of the unlawful assembly or they participated in the crime. And this has a support also from the fact that under the Indian Penal Code, in certain crimes, an exception has been made out in the sense that even preparation has been made a crime, as far as dacoity is concerned, sedition is concerned. Even a membership of a criminal gang is also a crime, like thugs, and there are certain provisions, still they are in the code. So coming forward now, we close this 34 and 149. Now we move to, very quickly we will try, because I think there are more than 1 hour, we will quickly move to abatement part. So the abatement, as all of us know, that it is from 107 to 118 IPC. And why the need of abatement of offense? And where the abatement of offense is to be applied? There are three ways in which abatement can take place. One is instigates any person to do that thing, or engages with one or more other person or person in any conspiracy. And that aid. If we pick up three words, there are three words: instigation, conspiracy, and aid. This is the backbone of abatement. Instigation, as we know, what is there. But one question often that is often asked in our classes is that the conspiracy that figures in abatement in second clause, and the conspiracy that figures in 120A and 120B. What is the difference between the two? Because when we apply these provisions, so the lawyers and the judges should be very much clear about the application. What is the difference between the two? Because here also engages with one or more other person in any conspiracy for the doing of that thing, if an act or illegal omission takes place in pursuance of that conspiracy and in order to the doing of that thing. So the basic difference that is there in this conspiracy and that conspiracy as defined under section 120 capital A is, here in order to come under abatement, it is necessary that there's, apart from conspiracy for the doing of that thing, if an act or illegal omission must take place. But as for a conspiracy under 120 capital A or 121 capital A is concerned, only agreement is sufficient. There is no requirement for any act, because the explanation to 120B or 120A itself says that agreement to commit an offense is itself and comes under conspiracy. So this is the first thing. The second thing is, practically, as far as criminal conspiracy under 120B is concerned, it is to be invoked only in larger offenses, not in minor and every petty offenses. Why? What is the basis of this assertion? The basis of this assertion is that in 1971, the Law Commission made a recommendation that the conspiracy should the reach of, because that is a very powerful section, read with section 10 of the Evidence Act. Mere agreement and section 10. So thereafter, on the basis of the recommendation of the Law Commission, 196 amendment was brought in section 196 of the CRPC. And in order to initiate a prosecution for criminal conspiracy, it is necessary that the offense concerned should be punishable for more than 2 years. So if it is 2 years or less, a sanction is required as per 196 CRPC. So moving forward, there are many the word instigate denotes incitement or using to do some drastic or inadvisable action. Law does not require instigation to be in particular form. It can be word by conduct and so on. We were discussing this part. Second, the offense of abetment created under section 107 requires that there must be some act. 120B for that, an offense of criminal conspiracy is, on the other hand, an independent offense. 120B is itself an offense. But for 109, because when we frame charge under 120B, it's not necessary that it should be read that it, because if a person is tried for murder, a tried charge under simpliciter 302 can be framed, and further he can be charged for 120B for committing the offense. But as far as abetment is concerned, if he's abettor to causing the death of any person, then 109 read with 302 of the IPC. So 120B is an independent offense, whereas section 109 is not. And also the as far as 196 CRPC, as I said, that there the prosecution in order to initiate prosecution under section 196, that is the requirement. These are the what are the evidence required for aid and so on. And here there is an interesting question came up in Gallusa versus State Offense of Bihar. The question is, if the principal of offense fails, if the charge against the principal offender fails, whether the abettor can be held liable. And here, this was a case where Gallusa had instigated or entered into conspiracy with one Budisa for setting on fire a house of a hut of a poor man person, and there that part Budisa was acquitted of the charge. Evidence could not be brought on record properly, but Gallusa was held liable, and this conviction was upheld by the honorable court, apex court. That even the principal offender is acquitted, the abettor cannot escape the liability. It was held that there are exceptions, particularly when there is evidence which establishes that the offense abetted is committed in consequence of abetment. How this provision is to be utilized? This Bank of India versus Yeturi Maredi Sankar Rao, AIR 1987, Supreme Court 81-821, demonstrates very well. We take up in our classes because suppose in case of forgery, because forgery, in order to prove the document has been forged, it has to be proved that the signature verifications and all the formalities has to be done before a person can be held guilty for an offense of committing forgery. Now, this was a case where the respondent of this case was Yuteri Marandi Sankar Rao, was a clerk in a bank. And what he did one day, he took the passbook of the victim on the pretext that he will update the entries. And after updating the entries, he will return it back to her. He took the passbook, but he did not return the passbook. After about a month, rupees 6,000 was withdrawn on the basis of a withdrawal form. And when the matter came in court, his signature did not tally with the signature on the withdrawal form. So the interesting part is, here 109 came to its rescue. Had he not been charged under 1467, read with 109, he would have been.
Who is the other accused, sir? Who is the other accused? You know, section 109, there has to be a principal offender, there has to be an abettor. In this case, you are referred only about one accused. Who is the other? What was the charge?
He was the sole accused, because the identity of the person who had produced could not be proved.
If he is the sole accused, where is the question invoking section 109? 109 to fall under any one of the limbs of 107.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yes.
Suppose it was not the prosecution case that there was none, but the other person was unknown.
Okay.
His identity was not established.
Okay.
The person who had signed the withdrawal slip was not established.
Okay.
But this was established that he was the person who had aided, assisted, and was able to withdraw the money. And therefore, Section 109 with read with 467 came into play.
Very good.
So, in such cases, in bank fraud cases and all, if the court or the lawyers and the prosecution is not cautious enough at the time of framing of charge under these provisions.
Sir, would it fall under Limb 2 of 107? Can't proceed?
Yes, sir.
Would it fall whether this case charge was under Limb 1 or 2 or 3 of 107? If it was conspiracy, if one man is acquitted, the other man cannot be convicted. What is the evidence to show that it was instigation or aiding or conspiracy?
Because 108 of the abettor, which...
Yes. One is an abettor. The person who abets, who instigates.
Yes.
He is the abettor. The other one is the principal abettor who commits there.
Yes,
so
sir.
That here 109, he is the abettor.
Yes, sir.
Is he the conspirator in terms of 107 too? The secondly of 107?
Sir, presently I cannot exactly, as far as this case is concerned. I have not gone, I cannot say with conviction what is exactly the total fact of the case, but these please. Are the broad outlines of the case, sir.
Please go ahead, sir. Please go. You are very elaborate already. Very good.
Sir, thank you.
Please go ahead.
So, as far as abettor is concerned, these are theoretical. A person abets explanation, the abetment of illegal omission of an act may amount to an offense, although the abettor may not himself be bound to do that act. Explanation two, to constitute the offense of abetment, it is not necessary that the act abetted should be committed. And so on. It is not necessary that the person abetted should be capable. If a child has been used as the principal offender, abettor cannot excuse from the liability. These are the general principles. So in this venue, I need not go in detail regarding these things. The abetment of an offense being an offense, the abetment of such an abetment is also an offense. Explanation five, it is not necessary to the commission of the offense of abetment by conspiracy that abettor should concert the offense person who commits it. So in this venue, I don't feel. The interesting part is about collateral act. This is a challenge, which we have discussed earlier also. Because once an act has been abetted and a different act takes place, so when the person has to be, principal abettor has to be made liable, that is a question that confronts the court at the time of adjudication. Because then there are two tests as far as Section 111 is concerned, we will discuss that, and 113 is concerned. Whether the act was probable or it was in a likelihood. We will go into those sections. What happened in Manbir Singh was state of UP when it was established that the co-accused had the gun and the belt of cartridge. This is a very common type cases. Suppose a crime takes place. A person commits shooting. I and along with my assistant go to a place and he is the main shooter. I do not do anything. I just close my hand, I say, ki maro, fire at him. So this is a situation where Section 34 will not be attractive. Section 149 will not be attractive. So here, in order to take care of this situation, when the person is giving a command, he's not doing anything, he is just commanding. Therefore, Section 109 comes to take care of such cases. So whenever such cases are, when the facts are such, we suggest the charge not under other sections, because direct 302, he cannot be made liable. When he gives the command, the person who commands 302-109. So this Manbir Singh was, sir.
I'm sorry, sir. Why not 34? Act need not be a physical act. This act of exhorting.
Participation, yes, sir. Yes, sir. When you are specific, because the question can be raised there. Sir, you have a valid point. Participation should be there. He did not participate.
He was present.
He was not watching the crime. He was not even watch. He was, because in Barinder Kumar Ghosh, he was participating because he was watching outside.
Well,
some form of watching is to be there. He simply gives it none.
From the narration of facts, what I understand is that he was present, he exhorted, he said, shoot him. So this is the active participation, he acts. So common intention can be hashed on the spot. Why can't we know section 34? Sir, Honorable Justice Ram Kumar, sir.
No,
you can also help us.
You are the best person to analyze these motions. I plead ignorance.
I am only putting this food for thought. yes. So it is empty. You see the difference. It is so
yes,
nice.
Yes, sir. So I got your point, sir.
You're right. If a person was guarding the room where the offense was committed, yes, can be roped in under section 34. Why not?
Yes. He was present. Yes. Act need not be a physical act. He does it.
But I saw, sir, yes, you are perfectly correct. But yes, what I have seen that whenever these command situations are there,
yes,
and when the person is commanding,
yes,
the mostly the charge under 302.109 goes.
Sir, interchange
because it directly applies to the cases. There before can be loosely applied. But here the first word is to instigate an offense, abatement. So it is quietly applies to the facts of the case.
I don't say that abatement is not. The section 109 is squarely applicable, no doubt about that. But at the same time, we cannot exclude section 34, that is my feeling. But
yes, sir. Yes,
both cannot be used in a given situation. Where lies the distinction? That's a difficult to understand this. Draw a different line is difficult.
Sir, I have a case further ahead.
Please go ahead.
That is a judgment by Justice Wadhwa. Justice Wadhwa was of the Supreme Court. He has tried to draw a line there. See if I can have that. So here, this is a simple assertion of the principle that when abatement has been done, abettor is liable, even if the person who is doing the act has done it with a different intention. Maybe good intention, bad intention of the principal offender does not matter. The intention of the abettor is important. So here, this is a case Mata Din. I was referring to, perhaps this is the case. Here, Mata Din versus State of Maharashtra. This is a judgment by Justice Wadhwa, as far as if I'm correct. 1999, Supreme Court 138. Here, sir, your charge was framed according to, sir, your school of thought.
Yes.
In this case, the charge was framed under Section 302 by 34 of the IPC against two accused persons. One of the accused of the appellant, Mata Din, other cause inflicted fatal knife injuries. We therefore set aside the conviction and sentence of Mata Din under Section 302, read with 34 IPC, and instead convict him under Section 324.110 IPC. So the principal offender, I think, furthermore. Exhortation of appellant Mata Din. Mata Din had exhorted to inflict fatal injuries. But the conviction of Mata Din under Section 3302, read with 34, was set aside. And instead, he was convicted under 324.110 IPC, sir.
324. The different intention. The different. Yes.
So then we come to, sir, 111, because 111 and 113 has to be read conjointly. As far as section 111 is concerned, it says when an act is abetted and a different act is done, the abettor is liable for the act done in the same manner and to the same extent as if he had directly abetted it. It does not matter what act was done. Even if it was a different act, if it was a probable consequence of abatement, the abettor cannot escape liability. Now, 13 says, liability of an abettor for an effect caused by the act abetted different from that. There the act was different. Here the effect is different. There the person abetted and acted differently. Here the effect is different. But still the abettor has been made liable if he knew that the act abetted was likely to cause that effect. I think I have this. Section 111 speaks of probable consequence. And section 113 and 149 speaks of collateral offenses being likely to happen. Practically, while appreciating evidence in cases, collateral offenses, the nature of offense also need to be considered. That is what we were discussing earlier, sir. In group and organized or gang crimes like robbery, arson, rioting, there is a higher probability of a prior concert and awareness of a probability of collateral consequence. So when the people have gone to commit arson in public property, they cannot escape the liability that, yes, I was the member of the unlawful assembly, but I did not know. However, in common crime, there need to be some tangible evidence of such awareness, common crimes. So coming to this part, this is also an interesting part where the question always arises how it is to be distinguished.
Yes.
Because correct. The evidence is present at the place correct. Of honor. So the difference is, sir, as we started in our discussion, that the scheme of IPC is about the accessories before crime, accessories at the crime, and accessories after the crime fact. So abettors are people who are supposed to be accessories before the crime and they are present at the place of occurrence. So if there is no evidence to the effect, if there is evidence to the effect that there has been abetment earlier and now he is simply present, then the proper section will be section 114 of the IPC. If there is no evidence of his prior abetment, there has been no evidence that he instigated, aided, or conspired with the principal offender earlier. In that case, the section 34 will come into play. So if there are some antecedent facts, prior facts, which shows that his complicity, his instigation, aiding, conspiracy, prior to the fact, then section 114 will come. And if it is not there, his participation is there, then section 34 will come into play. This is the fine distinction between 34 and 140.
Sir, here I want to explain one thing.
Sir, please.
I think that you are nearing conclusion of your lecture. No, sir, something more. No, if you've got many more things to say, that I will reserve this question, I will ask at the end. So I do not want to interrupt.
Okay, sir. No, you can ask just now, sir, because now this topic is being discussed, sir.
Okay. This is very interesting. Sir, referring to section 114, you rightly said that if the abettor is present on the spot when the principal offender commits the crime, then if the abetment is proved, then he can be punished. Now let me give one issue, sir. A instigate B to commit murder of one X. Okay, sir. A instigate B to commit murder of one X. Now B goes there. He commits murder. Now quite naturally, B will convict A for abetment, B for murder. Correct? So each will be given one life sentence. Now, suppose after instigating, this man accompanies him, goes there, being present when B commits a crime. Now, A, in my perception, is liable for two life sentences. One, the act of abetment is an independent offense under 109. Then after having abetted, he goes to the spot, being present, and according to the fiction created in section 114, he has also committed the offense. Therefore, for that, there has to be another life. He should suffer two life sentences. Sir, am I right, sir? What is your comment on this, please?
For abatement, 114 is about abatement.
109. Suppose a person commits an abatement.
So, sir, your point of view is that he should be charged both under 109 and 114.
Yeah, therefore, two life sentences for him. it makes all the difference for a person who simply instigates and doesn't go there. So for the abatement 109, 302, reduce section 109, he will be convicted. The person who is abated, who gets abatement, he goes to this spot, commits crime, he is a principal upon
his
own life.
I differ, sir.
Yes.
With the section, let us go to section 71 of the IPC.
Yes.
Because... So
109, I understand that. 109 is an independent offense or not? Yes. You will agree with me that section 109 is independent offense.
Yes, sir, certainly.
Sir, A instigates, B to commit crime. Offense is complete. Offense is complete because B commits the crime later. So even if B doesn't commit the crime, so far as 109 instigation part is concerned, he is liable for punishment. Only for conspiracy part alone, some act should have been done in pursuance of the conspiracy. So for instigation, mere instigation makes out the offense. The person need not go there. So it makes the difference for a person after abatement who does not go there, and a person after abatement who goes there and being present.
But
114, please see, he shall be deemed to have committed such act or offense. So he is a principal offender as well as for being an abettor, which is an independent offense, one life. Then he goes to the spot, not stopping with a mere abatement. He goes to the spot, participates in the, he is present. By a fiction, he also commits the offense of murder. So for that, invoking like section 34, he invokes section 114, punish him for life, and for the first offense, another life. Am I right, sir? You agree with me?
Yes, sir. But even then, where the two life sentences are awarded, both have to run concurrently.
That is different. That is different.
Whether he requires two sentences is the question. Whether he requires two sentences is the question.
Whenever any person who is absent, who if absent would be liable to be punished as an abettor, he is present.
Deemed to have committed that crime, that is murder. Like the other man.
If absent, it falls under 109.
Oh, not that. If he is only, he has only abated.
Absent and 109.
And if present, if present, 114.
One more offense he commits. One more offense he commits. For the offense, not for abatement. 104 says, for the offense he is liable.
When any person who is absent would be liable to be punished as an abettor, he is present when the act of offense for which he would be punishable in consequence of abatement shall deem to have committed such act of offense.
He is deemed to have committed this offense. That is murder.
Sir, should I read section 71 IPC, sir?
Yes. Now, one more thing, sir. Incidentally, I will raise one more issue also for our debate. That also you can comprehensively answer referring to section 71. We want to know your views.
Yes.
See, you take... Yes, sir, please.
No, here I think, because suppose he abets and then stops there. He is not coming to the place.
Yes.
Then they are thinking of two situations.
Yes.
See, if it is, he stops there, probably his act is over.
Yes.
But when he accompanies and goes there and see that it is executed, probably I think, according to me, maybe right or not, because the earlier act of abatement merges with the act of associating and committing the crime. So 109 loses its importance and thereby 114 and one offense is committed.
Okay. This is one view and...
One view possible.
I will give you one more issue now. Please kindly consider that also.
Yes, sir.
Suppose, sir, five people are there. Okay, sir. Five people are there. And they assemble at a place. They hatch a conspiracy. What is the conspiracy? To go and commit the murder of one X. If, sir, this is 120B. Suppose three persons alone go there and commit murder. For those three persons, two life sentences, one for conspiracy, which is an independent offense, and for committing actually the murder, another life.
Yes, certainly.
So, there are distinct. Now.
Yes. I have passed such an order, sir.
Yes. I just say, correct. Five people form an unlawful assembly, sir.
Why the difference is, sir, because conspiracy is an independent offense.
Correct. That is what I am saying. But I got no disagreement. I fully agree.
Here it needs, it has to be at 109 has to be at with 302.
No, I fully agree with you, sir. I fully agree with you. I got one more issue. Issue is this, sir. This is the issue. Sir, five people assemble. They hatch a common object. They form a common object. Now, all the five go to the spot. See, they commit murder. This is one issue. Other one, five people conspire. All the five go and commit murder. Then, for these five people in the second illustration, two life sentences. One, conspiracy and independent offense, life. Then they go there, commit the crime, another life. Only five. Correct, sir?
Yes, sir.
Same issue. I put it in this way.
Second act of committing crime by whom?
All the five.
Not one of them.
All the five. Two life sentences both. For all the five. Correct, sir?
Okay. Sir, sir, conspiracy and these are both, to my little understanding, are different because here, whenever charge is to be framed with 109, 302,
sir, 302 no, no, for, sir, 41, forget about 109. We are on the charge of conspiracy. So, forget about
41. See, it will happen.
120
doubt about it. 41 only forget about conspiracy. 100% it will be there.
Yes. Two life sentences, correct, sir?
Yes.
Five people commit the crime.
So yes.
Very good. Now, the issue is actually this. Five people gather and they form a common intention. All the five go and commit murder. Now, how many sentences are now? Only one life sentence you are giving.
Yes, sir.
Invoking section 149, you convict them all. Correct, sir?
Now,
why can't I say that what the assembly here, forming themselves into an unlawful assembly with a common object amounts hatching of conspiracy? Five people assemble here. What is conspiracy? It is not written conspiracy. Some understanding, pre-meeting of mind, some understanding between them to commit a crime. All the five assemble here. One may call it as hatching of conspiracy. The other one may call it as forming of unlawful assembly. You can call it in any way. What is the difference between these two? If you say that it is conspiracy, two life sentences. If you say no, it is only common assembly is formed here. The assembly goes there. Then there is only one life sentence. So there is contradiction in this also.
Yes, sir.
That is true.
You are great.
In no case, where we invoke 149, we give two life sentences. 149, if it is invoked, one life sentence. We say that common assembly can be, common object can be formed on the spot. Common intention can be formed on the spot, one aspect. Suppose common object was formed sometime before. What is object? Object is nothing but an agreement. All the five assemble here, they decide to go and kill. It is agreement. It is conspiracy. So according to every
case of 149, should have 120B also.
Sir, it gives room for such kind of interpretation or not?
Probably misunderstanding is that for the purpose of conspiracy, there must be a prior date of incident.
Not necessary.
The concept is that you have to conspire first. And thereafter, come and do it on a particular, on a different date.
I am saying here we assemble in this, at the house of A1, all the five assemble. They discuss, we should go and kill. So this we say the common assembly is formed. Assembly moves to the next house and kills. We call it as 149. They came from there. Together they came. All were armed with weapon. They came together. You show that they had common object. Therefore they killed.
So according to you, safer to have two charges, 120B and 149.
Yes. Even yes. One fails, other can be executed.
Now I would invite our speaker. Sir, now referring to section 71, you want to say something. Take this issue also in your mind, then please kindly explain. These are all food for thought.
Yes, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, under section 71, I had nothing new to add. Just I wanted to remind limit of punishment of offense made up of several offenses.
Yes.
A limit of punishment of offenses made up of several offenses.
Hmm.
Where anything which is an offense is made up of parts, any of which part is itself an offense.
Hmm.
The offender shall not be punished with the punishment of more than one of such offenses.
Here two offenses,
unless
sir.
Unless it be so expressly provided.
Well, here, it is not as though one single offense is formed by several parts, by several acts. Two distinct offenses.
Yes.
Assembly is formed in the house of A1. Then the assembly moves. If you call
maybe,
it
sir,
as...
Maybe, sir.
Yes.
Maybe, sir.
And Section 26 of the General Clauses Act.
Yes.
Same facts constituting the offense becoming an offense under two different enactments. Statute.
Yes.
They can be prosecuted, convicted. Only one punishment.
Yes. So that is same act falling under two different penal provisions. But exactly. Here they fall under two different penal provisions, two different acts virtually, not same acts. One act of assembly. Yes. Therefore, we have not thought of a situation where when the people assemble at a particular place and decide to go in an assembly to kill, there is conspiracy.
Sir, why don't you address the police academy? They need such training.
Yes, similarly, all right, I think I do not want to disturb our speaker because I am only moderator.
No, sir. Yes. You have made the discussion very lively, sir.
Yes, yes.
I will try to quickly wrap up, sir.
Please, kindly do it. Please,
conspiracy
please
part.
Please.
I move to conspiracy part, sir.
Yes.
So please. Conspiracy is a, as I said, that this is a, this provision was brought on the statute book in 1930, Criminal Law Amendment Act 1930.
Yes.
Before that, conspiracy was there in Indian Penal Code in the form of sedition and others. Sedition provision was there, 121A and other. But conspiracy as such was not there. In 1913, it came in the statute book. So the way it has been worded, an illegal act or an act which is not illegal by illegal means. So this is the, here the proviso that I was referring to earlier while discussing abatement, provided that no agreement except an agreement to commit an offense shall amount to a criminal conspiracy unless some, except unless some act decides. So mere agreement is itself an offense. That is 120A. Section 10 is a very interesting section, and it is of much help during prosecution because it says that anything said, done, or written by a co-conspirator can be used against this other conspirator. That is the crux of Section 10. Anything said, done or written by a co-conspirator in reference to the conspiracy, after the conspiracy, it can be used. So as far as Section 10, this is a departure in normal criminal law in the sense that normally the act of the accused cannot be the words a word said, written, or done. Anything said or written cannot be used in evidence unless a co-accused has been declared a approver under 306 of the CRPC. But this is a departure. So if the co-accused, who is a co-conspirator, has written a letter, he has said something, and the evidence has come on record, then that part of his statement, either written or verbal, can be used against his co-conspirator. So the only, instead of going through the other cases, I will just recall the Kehar Singh case, Indira Gandhi murder case.
Indira Gandhi murder case.
And also very recently the Nalini case. So in for all my young friends here, in Indira Gandhi murder case, as you remember, it took place in 1984. There were two assailants, Bihan Singh and Satwan Singh. One of them was shot dead on spot. Another was Satwan Singh, who was put on trial. Now this Kehar Singh was put on charge under conspiracy. He was not there at the place of occurrence. The only statement against Kehar Singh was of Bimla Khalsa, perhaps the widow of Bihan Singh or Satwant Singh, either of the two, she was the widow. And the statement she gave, the evidence that she gave before the court, that Kehar Singh used to come to their house and they used to talk very in a secretive way. What they talked, CCT did not say. But they said that Kehar Singh was in close contact with Satwant Singh and Bihan Singh. He had taken both of them to Golden Temple. And there he had given them Amrit Chakna. And thereafter this incident was come. So on the basis of these evidence, Kehar Singh was held guilty under section 120B for conspiring against them. So in case of conspiracy, there cannot be a direct evidence. Express agreement between parties cannot be proved. Circumstances, so it is the agreement part is proved on the basis of circumstantial evidence. So with this part, we have already discussed, sir, abatement difference.
Sir, this you may also refer to the Navjot Singh Chandu's case.
Parliament attack.
Because section. 120B is such a powerful section, read with section 10.
Yes.
That even if the main charge fails, yes, as happened in Muhammad Khalid case, West Bengal.
Yes. Yes.
The Muhammad Khalid case was about where some people had kept explosives in their house. In Bahu Bazar, the market, it was a big house, and it led to explosion, in which the house collapsed, killing many.
Yes.
So the accused was the Muhammad Khali was put on charge under section 302 and 120B.
Yes.
With other sections, 302 could not be proved. Intention, knowledge to commit anybody's murder could not be proved. But the substantive offense was, the charge failed. But Muhammad Khalid was held guilty under section 120B of the IPC.
Yes.
So.
Now, one more thing also, sir.
In a minute, sir, can a person charge? Now, this is one question. If you on charge, I want to just, before concluding, I want to put some questions on charge. When only the principal offense has been charged and no charge of the abatement of, if the principal offense has charge has been framed for abatement under principal offense, but abatement charge has been framed, conviction for abatement cannot be returned. Judgment of conviction of cannot be passed. But there are judgments to the effect where the accused has been charged for abatement. And if the charge of abatement fails, he can be convicted on the basis of evidence on record for the principal offense.
No, no, you are right, sir. If that is the case falling under this secondly of 107, because under 107, secondly, both are principal offenders.
Yes, sir.
Both.
Yes.
Because equal participants. But so far as if 1 and 3 are concerned, the person who instigates is the abettor, the other one is the principal offender. So for the second part, conspiracy is concerned, both are equal. Who instigates the other? Not there. Both agrees. Therefore, both stand in the same footing. In that case, it is possible. But if the allegation is that he only instigated and he was not present on this part, then he cannot be convicted on a section 109 when there is no evidence of abatement. He cannot be convicted for the principal offense. He can be convicted only by invoking section 114, provided he was present there.
Yes, sir.
That too, when the abatement is also proved.
So that is exactly what has been stated in Suhan Lal versus State of Punjab.
Yes.
It is 2003 Criminal Law Journal 49 Supreme Court. Accused charged under section 302 cannot be convicted with section 109 because abatement is a substantive offense and absence of charge causes prejudice to the accused.
I would like to add one more thing, sir,
to add flavor
to what you have said so far, that our law commission has recommended and has found, in fact, that limb 2, secondly of 107 has become redundant after the introduction of 120A and 120B, and therefore this should be repealed. Law commission has made a recommendation.
Oh,
So yes. When this 120B and 120A are there, you cannot invoke Section 109 at all so far as conspiracy party is concerned. And thus, according to the Honorable the Law Commission, so this is what the Law Commission says.
That is 1971 Law Commission, sir.
Yes. See, Law Commission says like this: despite the obvious and considerable overlapping between 120A, 120B, and the provisions governing abatement under Section 107, the legislature did not think it necessary to amend the earlier chapter in any way. Then it says, after 120A and B were introduced, abatement by conspiracy is a little practical use and is redundant as a criminal law concept. That is what Law Commission has said. So the Law Commission itself find it is true also. See, when conspiracy to become an abatement in terms of Section 107, some follow-up act should have been committed towards the achievement of conspiracy. If nothing is said, it is no offense at all.
Certainly.
All right. Certainly. If suppose the conspired act is committed, then 120B is there for mere conspiracy, 120B. Then for the principal offense committed like murder, there is separate offense, but there is punishment. Then where to invoke Section 109 at all in the light of 120B? So therefore, after the introduction of 120A and 120B, there is no scope
of second, part, second part has become redundant to a great extent.
No chance.
I think pursuant to that Law Commission report, that 196 CRPC has been amended.
When Justice Ian Prakash addressed us, he also mentioned that.
Okay. Regarding this conspiracy aspect.
Yes.
Yes, sir, we can.
There is no doubt that where the charge under 149, read with 3-2, not 2 has been framed, conviction can under Section 34 can be passed. That is William Slaney and also later judgments also. But where the charge has been framed under Section 34, read with Section other, then the conviction under 149 cannot be awarded because 149 is a distinct offense.
I also want to add one more thing, sir.
Yes, sir.
That we have not discussed so far. What is common object? So common object as defined in Section 141. The object of the assembly should be to commit any one of the offenses enumerated in Section 141, not every offense. Suppose five people assemble, and the object of the assembly is to go and commit murder. You please kindly look at Section 141. And there is no common unlawful assembly at all. Kindly see 141 now. Unlawful assembly. An assembly of 5 or more persons is designated an unlawful assembly if the common object of the persons conferring that assembly is, first, to overrun by criminal force or show of criminal force the central or any state government, we are not there. Two, to resist the execution of any law or any legal process. Third, to commit any mischief. See, mischief. 427, 428, 430, 436, like that. Or show of criminal force to any person. To commit any mischief or criminal trespass or other offense. So whether this other offense is governed by the doctrine of legestum generis or not is the point. Now, our High Court has said that that principle of adjustum generis is not applicable. Other offense means any offense under the IPC. That is a view taken by Honorable Justice Ibrahim Galifullah very recently.
Even that's murder.
Murder also. But the I also given a very detailed lecture on this. Singapore Court, three judges bench held that the doctrine of adjustum generis apply for this, and therefore it is not every offense. But that was overruled subsequently by 5-judge bench of Singapore court. In Sri Lanka, they still hold that any offense, other offense does not mean every offense under the
APC. Interesting point, sir.
Yes, adjustum generis. Now our Supreme Court has held like this. Now, if had it been the intention of the legislature to make every offense as an object, so as to fall under section 141. Why should this classification? There need not be specification like this. They can very well say, like this, if the common object of the person composing that assembly is to commit a crime under this, under the code, or under any other law, they could have said so. They have not said that it is to commit a crime and any offense under the code or any other special law. They specifically say, if only the object is to commit any one of these offenses, then there is unlawful assembly. No, if the assembly decides to go and kill, that is why he say that we have to frame charge under 120B for that assembly.
You are right.
But as per the judgment of the present judgment of the Supreme Court, just a Gallipola judgment, I forgot, I got it there. If I go sir, there, I will like go out of the camera.
Citation is there.
Yes. Just a Gallipola judgment, sir. So I will put it in the chat box just now. I got it there.
Okay,
sir. Yes. He says, any offense means, any offense under the IPC, if there had it been the intention of the legislature, my question is this. Why should there be this specification? They could have simply said, if the object of the assembly is to commit any offense under the Indian Penal Code or any other special enactment, they could have said. So obviously I got very difficult, difficulty in accepting the view of the Honorable Supreme Court. So if you apply the doctrine of adjustum generis, other offense means any offense
related to
property. The common threat is mischief, an offense against the property. Show of criminal force against property. So that alone, not murder.
My goodness.
This I made a thorough research on this.
I had not looked at from this angle, sir, to be very frank.
Yes.
I had not looked at this section from this angle.
Yes.
I was unaware of that. But therefore, sir, it is a very valid point. Sir, you have stated a very valid point.
Yes, I have now collected the notes prepared by Mekale before drafting this IPC. That notes I am reading. I want to see as to what he has felt. But the very same issue came up before now our High Supreme Court, or Supreme Court of Singapore.
So that notes, sir, is there in a book. What is the name of the book?
Sir, I have it, sir. I have it in my cell phone.
Okay, sir. I will share. I will try to get it, sir.
And I will.
Okay.
The entire notes prepared. And not only on this regarding Evidence Act also. Stephen's commentaries on IPC and other things. We have to see that. So there is no uniformity.
sir, thank you, sir, so much.
Thank you. Thank you. So as my concluding remarks, that today's discussion was very interesting.
You touched upon
all the points which are required. Yes. And it was really wonderful. And today, for want of time, we could not go into the special enactment where vicarious liability is created specifically. That is another area that may require one full session for us to discuss regarding.
I have to continue the deliberation. Like always, every session throws up certain questions. Things we have been consistently having. We might require one exclusively for that.
Yes, not only that, even in the subject which we have discussed today, for want of time, we could not touch upon various other nice points, very, very, very deep points which are also involved. We'll discuss about them. So regarding 34 and 37, Mr. Menon is there.
Yeah, very much.
Sir, I am here.
Yes, please. So with this, I conclude. Therefore, I throw it open for our dear members to raise their queries and get answers from our speaker, Honorable Speaker. Sir, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and your very excellent session you had, really. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Before we go on to the interactive sessions, may I request Justice Ramkumar, sir, for the comments?
Why should I make any comment? Comments have already come. Mr. Gautam Kumar initiated us into this great lecture, and it was catapulted by Justice Nagamuthu. What we have seen is an orchestra with physical and virtual performance.
But there is no common intention.
common interest.
Whatever that has been thrown open today, Should yes. we have a session next week itself so that this will remain really
definitely.
Remember everything, and we can just as an extension of today's session, depending upon the dates available to Nagamuthu sir and all of you, of course.
Yes,
Gautam Kumar sir.
Excellent lecture, Mr. Gautam Kumar. You have done a very wonderful lecture. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Prem, what is this? You are very silent today.
Not yet.
What you asked was a very, very relevant question, and I would just like to explain for a minute or so. Please. See, section 34 to 37, they are included in chapter 2, which deals with the title called General Explanations.
Yes.
And of course, explanatory in content. Now, yes. Just see, there is a three-judge ruling right during 1958. Srikanthaiah was the state of Mysore, AR 1958, Supreme Court 672, which would say that section 34 to 38 of the Penal Code, they delineate the parameters of what is called the constructive or vicarious penal liability in different situations. It's not imperative that a charge should contain a particular section of IPC, which we all know. At any rate, and even an omission to frame a charge, it's maximum. It's not an irregularity which may vitiate the the conviction itself. And kindly see, sir, the speaker was saying about William Slaney's case. Not only William Slaney, we have Wasim Khan versus State of UP, 56 Supreme Court, page 400. Same year. Then we have Mubarak Ali, 57 Supreme Court, 857. You have Bhur Singh, 74 Supreme Court, 1256. And Justice Jam Kumar was saying, what section 34 said was an act, because it is a criminal act. Now, kindly see, to attract 34, it is not necessary that a particular act, which is detached from the other acts, it by itself is a criminal act. True, 34 may mention like a criminal act, but that particular expression in that particular word act, that is again defined. Kindly see section 33. 33 says the word act would denote a series of acts as a single act.
Or omissions of.
Singular includes plural.
Because it is a series. That is what
section 33. Act a series acts. That is why.
Exactly. So what Justice Nagamuthu told is absolutely correct, because even in participation in action, it is a prominent feature of 34. Everybody would know that. And its essence is to be found in the very existence of that, what you call the common intention, which animates a perpetrator to the doing of that act. Now, physical presence at the spot is not necessary to attract that particular thing. Because we have seen Srikanthaiah Ramaiah's case, 1955 Supreme Court 287. That's an
essential proposition.
Justice Vivian.
Yes.
For the bench. Then section 34, we have indicated close reading of 34 means 33, which proceeds, lays down that the act denotes not only a single act, but a series of acts. And see, the entire proposition, this particular 34 to 38, it has been explained by the Privy Council very beautifully. Barendra Kumar Bose case, which you may be knowing, sir. AR 1925 Privy Council, page 1.
That is referred to.
AR 1925 Privy Council, page 1.
That is referred to.
This Privy Council decision that was reiterated by Justice Hidayatullah in that Afram Sheikh's case, 64 Supreme Court, 1263. And kindly see what section 35 says, or 37 says, or 38 says. Every illustration, and 34, according to me, merely speaks of a criminal act which is done by several persons in furtherance of a common intention. That is further intention, the common intention should be to all. And it has to be regard not to the offense as a whole, but only to the criminal act. That is the totality of the series of the acts which would...
Mr. Prem, we fully agree with you. And you reserve everything for our next session. One more thing I want to play before you. One more thing also. Literally, what is the difference? Literally, I'm not in the legal sense. I'm asking. Literally, what is the difference between in furtherance of and in prosecution?
Yes.
How to draw a line between these?
Yes.
In furtherance of or in prosecution.
Or common object and common intention.
Yes. What is?
Why can't we have it on Monday, 13th? We'll complete this.
Monday is too early.
Monday is too early. Fine. Well, let us decide the date also so that we can coin that both the issues, and we'll just cover that with all the relevant.
Correct.
Judicial problems.
This is a very, very important topic which needs great deliberation. great link, I would say.
Very often we get confused. And okay. Quotes, even I say that you can see the recent judgment of Honorable Justice Chalmeshwar, where I assisted the court as an amicus curiae in 2017 to 2018 SEC. I forgot on the page. You just see the judgment also. So how charges were filed? That was a case from Gujarat High Court. Ultimately, I suggested to the court, you pay compensation, you cannot do anything after 25 years, you cannot remand the case. The court directed payment of compensation of 1 crore. Yes. Ultimately, I quit it. Sir, sheer ignorance of the trial court and the high court.
Correct.
That he has recorded also in the judgment. Matter was argued, so I think that recording can be closed. Mr. Shyam, you can record the close the recording.
It was Kodagali.
Kodagali. So we'll just complain that.
Close the recording. You can close the recording. We can speak freely.
Close the recording. We can say it off records.
Persons died. 17 accused arrayed. Charged under Section 302 must have been framed on 3 counts against specifically named accused with respect to each of the deceased. Distinct charges should have been framed specifying which of the accused are charged for causing the death of which one of the 3 different deceased. Charge should have also been proved clearly under Section 302 with or without help of Section 149. A person cannot be charged under Section 147 and 148 both. However, defective framing of charge would not render conviction invalid. This is the head note, sir.
Yes, yes. And however, they found that the miscarriage of justice would be caused. Therefore, they set aside.
The citation? So that many persons are asking for the citation in the
chat. Citation is 2000. We had referred to this in our reading material. 2018, volume 7, SCC 743.
In fact, Honorable Justice, my brother Ramkumar Jay.
Yes, yes.
So virtually, the judges were shocked when they said, It will take a few minutes. Yes,
you are acquitting the accused and ordering compensation.
I started saying that we cannot do anything. I started like this. We can't do.
This is the court. We place on records and so.
Yes, yes.
Supreme Court under Section 1, Article 142 can do any wonders.
Yes.
Can they overthrow the Constitution itself, sir?
So, sir, we'll definitely reserve a day this coming week itself so that I'll get the convenience of all of you, Gautam Kumar Chaudhary, sir, yes. Narayamuthu, sir, Ram Kumar, sir, Ramushan, sir, and of course, Abraham Matthew, sir, and all. I will even get Professor Call also involved in that so that we'll definitely have.
Brother Abraham has not expressed his views on this.
I'm sorry, sir.
Brother Abraham.
He just 10-15 minutes left. Ago sent a message and he just left. He has said in the evening for the judicial officers.
Yes, so, Mr. Shyam, you can throw it open for the others to ask few questions so that our speaker can answer.
Definitely. Yes, for that matter, what I can do is today we are almost reaching 6 o'clock right now. Now that if you are having a continuation session, if there is any questions to be put now itself, there is you can put your hand icon so that
you can forward those questions to Mr.
Gautam,
and he will give a written reply either tomorrow or
everybody is aware about our WhatsApp group and also the email ID. Just send it across so that all those can be incorporated. The answers will be given by Gautam Kumar Chaudhary sir, and all issues can be dealt with, especially those interesting issues that has cropped up today thanks to Nagamuthu sir. We'll definitely address, and end of the day it is legal empowerment through interaction. This is what we intend and this is what we got. Wonderful session. So Ramashan sir, you want to add something?
Yes sir, I will, because presence of Justice Nagamuthu has made this more innovative and also because though he is a lawyer, he has become more academician to put the hypothetical provisions and then made the discussion more alive. And really, Chaudhary Saab, you have done a good job.
Thank you.
In coordinating all the sections and also the correct relevant the decisions on those aspects.
In a very organized manner.
Expressed in a simple language.
Methodologically
also you have put it. So very very nice lecture. It gives more, throws more light for further discussion. Not only for the discussion, but also kindle our thought to think in a different way. Also sometimes. Thank you, brother.
You want to add something, Prem? Over to you.
Yeah, it was a good talk, but I would say, because the nuances, it has to be cut or sliced into really niceties, as Justice Nagamuthu has asked you.
Attempted.
Not only attempted, sir, it is absolutely brilliantly he has said that. See, 34 to 38 means it is a package by itself. It's a package. It's only a rule of evidence. It's a package by itself. And when he has said that, because it is absolutely correct. What he said is correct. It is supported by Kitchener rulings. And even with regard to that 114 and 109, both are separate offences. Or else, why did the legislature, I mean the British Parliament at that point of time, why did they incorporate 114? See, 109 illustration, see, you have the same one thing. And 114 says it's a separate offence. Both are separate offences. So I would say, actually, we want Justice Nagamuthu to lead us from the front.
And that illustration, that illustration, brother,
jailer.
That illustration jailer. Given, that will come under Section 34 also.
Exactly, jailer. It will come under 34 also. Exactly, no doubt about that. Because on a primary blush, we would feel that it is all overlapping. But when you closely read that, keeping in mind that what if 34 to 37 means it is only under that explanatory part, and this is falling under the offence part. So automatically, what you said, this is absolutely brilliant. Absolutely brilliant, I would say. And thank you so much for, sir, for the class.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Prem. Thank you.
Brings us to the end of the 79th session of Legal Empowerment Through Interaction Lecture Series. We are deeply indebted and thankful to Sri Gautam Kumar Chaudhary, who is in fact the director of Ranchi Jharkhand Judicial Academy, for initiating the deliberations, introducing the subject, and to Nagamuthu sir for rather making more interesting and entertaining and invigorating. And Justice Ram Kumar sir, Justice Ramakrishnan sir, and Justice Abraham Mathew sir for being present and the valuable inputs. And here we say goodbye with the promise that we'll be back on that nuances and those finer aspects which has been highlighted today. In the coming week itself, we'll find out a way of to get a date in the next week itself, so that we can go deep into it, so that the very purpose of this platform, common platform, can be, we can really make use of that. Tomorrow, we have a speaker from United Kingdom. She is the senior lecturer in the University of Liverpool School of Law and Social Justice. The topic for tomorrow would be decoupling free speech from the yoke of criminal defamation restraints. She's Dr. Sujitha Subramanian, and introducing the topic tomorrow will be Honorable Justice A.K. Jayashankaran Nambiar of the High Court of Kerala. So till we meet again tomorrow 3:30, do take care and keep on deliberating on the issues that we thought of today. Thank you, Mr.
Gautam. Thank you very much for the excellent session. As a moderator, I should thank you one. Thank you, and all the other participants. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.